to quote the defendant, and pardon my language, he was one of those that get away. Pardon my language. He was one of those punks.
Quoting George Zimmerman's own words, the prosecution today said those words help prove that he's guilty of second-degree murder. But now the jury will also be allowed to consider the lesser charge of manslaughter. And that could prove crucial to the verdict that they reach in this case. Back with me is our legal panel. Lisa, let me start with you because you have to leave in a minute and we'll see you later in the show. How important is second lesser charge for the jury to consider?
I think it's extremely important. Many people have said this is a manslaughter case, not a murder case. I've always disagreed. Well, not always, but since the close of the prosecution case, I thought they put on a good case, actually, for second-degree murder. I just don't think they put it away today in closing argument. Bottom line is, I think you have to present the evidence for both. You present it in the alternative. You know, you certainly hit hardest at the top charge, but they have the manslaughter charge. They're going to be instructed on it. You don't ignore that. You talk about that charge as well. I think either one, a conviction on either one, would be a clear win for the prosecution.
Marcia, here are the charges that the jury will consider. Second-degree murder, which carries a maximum sentence of life in prison, and manslaughter, which, if done with a firearm, has a maximum sentence of 30 years in prison. So if they convict on either one, it is significant punishment. Clearly doesn't return any kind of life to the family because they've lost their son and brother, but it clearly is punishment.
That's true, and it's significant. And, you know, the problem is that in every murder case, we cannot bring the victim back. I mean, ultimate justice would be the victim comes back. But we can't do that. And so the only thing you can do is punish the defendant with as significant a punishment as the conviction warrants. In this case, either conviction is going to wind up being a very significant sentence for him, and I think that's appropriate.
Ken, you know, the prosecutor talked today about assumptions. He said that George Zimmerman made the night that he shot Trayvon Martin a lot of assumptions. Listen to this.
This defendant made the wrong assumption. He profiled him as a criminal. He assumed certain things, that Trayvon Martin was up to no good. And that is what led to his death. What started this? Assumptions. Incorrect assumptions on the part of one individual.
Isn't that the theme of the prosecution? Isn't that the theory of their case, that this accused, Mr. Zimmerman, started with assumptions, profiled Martin, killed him, and lied about it? Ken?
Reverend, the reason that he does not get an A-plus and gets a C-plus to a B-minus in my book is that he used the word assumption. Assumption is a wimpy word. Zimmerman didn't make assumptions on that night. He made prejudgments. He prejudged this young man with a hoodie as being a criminal. He prejudged a whole bunch of things. He didn't make assumptions. That's a very neutral word. So I didn't like the use of that word. But yes, his theme overall, I think, was effective. It goes into that web of lies. There's these prejudgments being made, and that goes to the elements of second-degree murder. But I agree, you know, with some of the commentators that this is not a very strong case for second-degree murder. It's a much stronger case for manslaughter. So I think when the jury is going to be hearing from the prosecution first, while they have all night to think about what the prosecutor says before the defense closing tomorrow, it would have been good to touch upon manslaughter and insert that in there in a certain way so the jury can start thinking about it without giving up the argument that it is, in fact, second-degree murder. So it's not an assumption. There were prejudgments by Zimmerman, and they were not neutral assumptions.
John Burris?
Absolutely, that's correct. I think the term here that no one's talking about, this was a racial profiling type of assumption and prejudgment, because when you think about it, he did it with respect to all the other cases that came in. They were all African-American young men. Here was another one that he saw, and he made certain assumptions about him, made prejudgments about him, and from there, his whole attitude and conduct was based upon that. That goes to the prosecution's theory about ill will and mental state that goes to second-degree murder. I don't know that it gets you all the way there, but he certainly had the predisposition at the time to prejudge this young man, and because he was an African-American male walking in the neighborhood wearing a hoodie, believed he was acting in a suspicious way, even though he wasn't. So that part is important. I think that at the end of the day, though, the prosecution has to deal with this whole question, though, happened during the course of that fight. Now, what they've done is try to build this case around circumstantial evidence, that is, lies that were told, and therefore you have it, circumstance you can infer by lying that he must have had a mental state that was consistent with the attitude that he had at the very beginning. That's a tough way to make it, but that's the road that they've gone down.
But Faith, we're dealing in Florida. Mm-hmm. Five members of the jury white. If he had brought up race without having specific evidence of race, could that have backfired?
Absolutely.
Didn't he say, by saying profiling and pre-assumptions, didn't he put where the jury may be able to see that without raising race, and then the defense saying, no one came in here and said there was a race problem?
The prosecutor's using the word profiling. These jurors know exactly what he is referring to. They know that the prosecutor is not saying that Zimmerman profiled Trayvon because he didn't like the kind of candy he was carrying. They know that the prosecutor's arguing he profiled him because of the way he looked and how he was dressed. They understand that. They also know that these prior calls are coming in and that his mindset started developing not on the night that he saw Trayvon Martin, but months prior to that, leading up to this incident and the night that he saw Trayvon Martin when he said, they're not going to get away. He meant it because then he followed him and confronted him.
Marcia, the prosecutor called Judge Zimmerman a wannabe cop. Listen to this.
Recall how he says that at one point that Trayvon Martin is circling his car? And my point in saying that is, number one, you've got to determine whether that's true. But let's presume that part is true. And he says he's got something in his hands. Why does this defendant get out of the car if he thinks that Trayvon Martin is a threat to him? Why? Why? Because he's got a gun. He's got the equalizer. He's going to take care of it. He's a wannabe cop.
Is that effective, Marcia?
Oh, I thought it was very effective, and I've been saying this all along, Reverend. You know, he started this knowing he had the lethal power in his pocket. He got out of that truck knowing that he had a gun. And, you know, that makes a whole different mindset. Now, what that should do, and a responsible gun owner will tell you, what that should do is make him feel even more restrained, even more careful, because he knows he has lethal power in his pocket,
right.
And you don't use that unjudiciously. But that's the problem with someone like George Zimmerman, who gets out of his truck with his big head of steam, which is what the prosecutor is talking about all the other cases where the cops messed up and didn't do anything about it, and the punks always got away, and he gets out and he's all puffed up with his gun, and he's going to run Trayvon Martin down. He's not scared. If he was scared and he was worried and he was frightened, then why did he get out at all? He knew the name of the street. I mean, I think that the prosecutor showed that beautifully by showing how he popped that name of the street right out during his conversation with the police.
And
let me
would,
point out one other thing, Reverend. Just want to say one thing about having to disprove that the prosecution has to disprove self-defense. So when they get into, everybody was saying, oh, why are they talking so much about the defense theory of the case? They are required to disprove self-defense, not just prove their case, but disprove self-defense. So they've got to attack those theories.
I have to take a break. I'll come back to you, Faith. Stay with me. There's much more from the trial today ahead. Coming up, we'll bottom line it. Did the prosecution prove their case, and how did the jury react today? We're live in Sanford, and what will the defense have to say in their closing argument? Plus, day after day 12 of testimony, what evidence and testimony had the strongest impact in this case?